Today I'm going to talk about a joint work we did this spring with a bunch of colleagues from INRIA Lille. So Pierre Ménard, who recently left us to do another postdoc in Germany, Omar Darwish Dominguez, who is a PhD student, Anders Johnson, who was doing his sabbatical with us, Edouard Laurent, who is a PhD student, and Michal Valko, who is in DeepMind. And so in this work, we studied two pure exploration problems in the context of reinforcement learning that I will try to describe shortly. So a very brief recap about reinforcement learning. So the common denominator of any reinforcement learning problem is that of an agent interacting with an environment by taking action and observing rewards and transition to next states as a consequence of its action. But there are several possible formalization for RL problems. And in particular, the theoretical RL community has come up with different types of performance measure. If we try to categorize them, the first category would be when you want your agent to, like you imagine it interact directly in the real world. And so it is very crucial to you that he directly adopt a good behavior, and measuring a good behavior for your agent could be measuring how many rewards it is accumulated during this interaction. So sometimes this is formalized by minimizing a quantity called regret, which is the difference between the Oracle performance, if you knew the environment, and the performance of your learning strategy. So there have been some other performance measure where, for example, you might look at all the action you took and you try to look at the policies you used in the different learning round and count the number of times you picked a policy which was not epsilon close to the optimal policy. So this is the so-called PAC-MDP formalization. And so in PAC-MDP, people sometimes look at sample complexity guarantees. So in this work, we will also talk about sample complexity, but it will be the sample complexity of different problems where you're okay if your agent is making a few mistakes during its interaction with the environment. Actually, all you care is that your agent is learning a good behavior at the end of the day. Even if it means making a lot of mistakes, as long as the agent is able to tell you, okay, this is how I should have behaved, this is a good policy for interacting with this environment. So the difference is really the constraint to maximize rewards on one side and the constraint just to output a good policy. And actually, we will consider two different variants of this good policy learning problem. So either the agent is given at the beginning a reward function, and then the goal is to find the optimal policy with respect to this known reward function. Or the agent is simply asked to have learn a good proxy for the dynamics of the environment in order to be able later to plan for any reward function it could be given. So this is a high level description of the two pure exploration problems that we will look at in this presentation. So we will look at them in the simplest possible model of environment in my view, which is an episodic Markov decision process. So episodic means that you are supposed to interact during H time steps with your environment, where H is a known horizon. And so as always, the Markov decision process is made of four different things. So you have the state space, and the action space, which will both be assumed to be finite in this talk. And then the environment is completely described by the transition kernel and the reward function, where, for example, here, pH of S prime given SA is the probability to end up in the next state S prime when you choose action A in state S at step H of your episodes. And this would be the expected reward you get when in step H you select action A in state S. So a policy is simply a mapping from a state to actions that indicates what the action, the agent following the policy will play. And observe that here the policy in the episodic MDP model, it's a non-stationary policy, so you could behave differently in different steps of the episode. And so policy are usually evaluated by value, which would be the expected cumulative reward you get when acting under the policy, starting from a particular state. And so an agent adopts a good behavior or learns a good behavior if he finds the optimal policy, because it is known from the theory of MDP that there exists a policy which is whose value is better than that of any other policy in any time step and in any S. So I'm just highlighting a few specificities of my notation. So as you already kind of understood, a reward will play a particular role in this talk. So that's why I choose to index all my values by R, which indicates the reward function at hand. Of course, the value also depends on the dynamics, so on the transition kernel of the MDP, but I will not make this dependency explicit. In particular, we will denote by P star of R, the optimal policy in the MDP for which the reward is R. Another, just mentioning sometimes I will work with Q value instead of value, which is classical in RL. So you start by taking an action and then following the policy. And also here I consider the most general episodic MDP in which the transitions and the reward are also allowed to vary across different time steps. This is just because half the literature is doing that, the other half is considering fixed reward and fixed probability, but it's just to handle the more general case. And in case you happen to know this literature, the bounds I will present can vary in terms of their scaling in the horizon H. So I hope the setup is clear. So what are my two objectives? So now that I presented the environment, it's time to say how we will learn in this environment. So our learning algorithm will be how we collect data in this Markov decision process. And in this work, we consider that we are only able to learn based on trajectories. So we do not have access to a generative model. So a generative model could be you could place your agent in any state and observe the resulting transition, that is the next reward and the next state. Here we are assumed that we always start somewhere in the MDP, perform a trajectory of length H, which is the length of our episode, and then we can start a new trajectory. So the learning process is therefore episodic, and for each new episode, the agent will pick an exploratory policy pi t, which can depend on the previous observed data. And then it will generate an episode under this policy by using the policy to pick the next action in a given state. And then the next state is obtained from the dynamics, the transition probabilities of the MDP. And so we assume that the first state of the episode is drawn from some distribution. For simplicity, we will assume, for example, that we always start in the same state S1. So it's easy to go from one to the other, but To keep the exposition simple, we will assume this. So the policy is really how you pick your exploratory policy. But in the pure exploration settings I'm concerned with, it's also important to decide when we have collected enough data to make a decision. So to decide when we want to stop exploration. So the stopping rule will be also data dependent. And if we decide to stop, we will output a prediction. And the prediction is actually the difference between the two settings. But I'm already highlighting that the three components, how you choose to perform, what policy you choose for the current episode, when you stop, and what you predict, the three are completely adaptative, data dependent. So the first setting we will talk about is the best policy identification. So it is when we are given the reward function beforehand. So the agent is allowed to use the knowledge of the reward in order to guide his exploration towards the interesting region of the environment. So many papers have looked at this setting. So for example, a note paper by Fichter in 1994 is already posing this problem. So it is in a different setting where there is a discount factor, and you assume that the agent has the option to restart in the first state. So it is kind of equivalent to the episodic setting. And an algorithm for best policy identification will be made so of the three components I already presented. So I highlight that the exploration policy depends on the past data, which is the collection of all the sequence of state action, next states we have observed in the past episodes, and also on the reward R. The stopping time can also depend on past data and on the reward, and the prediction, same here, depends on the data you've observed until stopping and on the reward function. And so our goal will be in this so-called pack learning framework to output a policy. So the prediction we make is a policy, it's P hat, and we want P hat to be as close as possible to a P star R, the optimal policy for this particular reward function. So in particular, we want that with probability larger than 1 minus delta, the value of the policy we output is epsilon close to the value of this optimal policy. And we wish to make this prediction using as few samples as possible, because remember that during this interaction with the environment, the agent can really behave suboptimally. So maybe you do not want to break your robot before knowing how to behave. And so we are interested in using as few samples as possible. So minimizing the number of episodes needed to find this good policy. The other setting is a bit more challenging. It has been formally introduced by Shijin this year at ICML. It is called the reward-free exploration framework. So in that case, our goal is to learn a policy, an optimal policy for any reward function that could be given to us after the exploration phase. So in other words, a possibility is to estimate well the unknown dynamic in order to after be able to solve a planning problem if we are given a reward. So what is different from the other setting is that now the algorithm, the exploration policy, the stopping rule and the prediction can no longer depend on a particular reward, because we need to be robust to any possible reward function. So therefore, there are still, depending on the data we collect during the interactions with the MDP in the past episodes. But what we predict will be this time a transition kernel. So an estimate of the unknown transition probabilities in the whole MDP. And so based on this transition kernel, when we have stopped exploration, we can try after that to, if we are given a function, a reward function R, we are able to compute the optimal policy in the empirical MDP whose transition is this estimate p hat and whose reward is the known reward function r. So in the episodic setting, this can be efficiently computed by doing a backwards induction. So here I'm always working in this simple tabular MDP with finite state action space. So all this is easily computable. But the guarantee we want for this estimate of p hat of the transition is that with probability larger than 1 minus delta, for every reward function, the optimal policy that we can compute with respect to this reward function is epsilon close to the value of the optimal policy for this particular reward function. So we need to be able to plan again for any possible reward. And the setup is the same. We wish to do that using as little exploration steps as possible. So those are my two problems. So what is a possible motivation for this reward-free exploration? So that was given by Shijin. So often the reward, if you do RL to train, a robot to do something, you do not necessarily know what would be a good reward to have your system do exactly what you have in mind. So you could imagine iteration in an engineering process to design some artificial intelligence where you try a first reward, you see that the agent is not exactly doing what you had in mind, you try another reward function and so forth. And so if each time you try a new reward function, you have to relearn the dynamic from scratch and the optimal policy, it's a bit annoying. So then if here we have a good estimate of the unknown, which is the dynamic of the environment, we manage to speed up the planning process with respect to different rewards. So this is one possible motivation. Another one is that there are many situations where you have very sparse reward. And so at the beginning of the learning, you have to know how to explore the environment without being guided by any reward function. So those would be two reasons why we want to study a reward-free exploration. And now I am going to describe you the algorithm we proposed for this this setting, which is called reward-free UCRL. So UCRL is a model-based algorithm. So a model-based algorithm is precisely an algorithm that will explicitly estimate the model, so explicitly estimate the transition probabilities. In order to then after estimate the important quantity, which are the Q values or the values. So this is in difference with model-based methods that just try to estimate the value directly. So the typical model-based algorithm in these tabular settings are based on very simple estimates of the transitions that relies on the number of visits, so the number of time you have been in some particular state action pair in the past episode, and also here the step matters. So you NHT SA is the number of time we've been in SA at step H, and so the empirical transition is what you expect. It's to estimate the probability to go in S prime, you will just count the number of time you ended up in S prime after taking action A in state S. And so you compute the fraction, the empirical distribution. And so based on this, we can indeed compute the empirical values, optimal value, optimal policies, just by defining them to be the value in the empirical MDP. So where we replace the unknown transition kernel by the estimated transition kernel made of all these estimate p hat. And so a central observation to design our algorithm is the fact that a sufficient condition to be to have a strategy which is epsilon delta pack for reward-free exploration is that when you stop your exploration, you are at some time tau, so this random time, you are actually able to estimate the value of any policy for any reward. So the reason for this, so based on the inequality here, so if this holds true for any pi and any r, you can easily show that, so for any reward, the value of the empirical optimal policy is epsilon close to the value of the best policy. And so based on this observation, we would like to stop when we have reduced this estimation error for all possible policies and all possible values. So this might sound like a tedious task because of, you know, enumerating all policies is of course very, very costly. But fortunately, we will manage to build upper bound on these errors. So I will work here with Q value. So I defined E hat HT pi to be the absolute difference between the estimated Q value of the policy pi in state action pair SA and the true Q value. And so as we will see on the next slide, we will build upper confidence bound on this quantity, which are independent of the policy pi and of the reward function. And so this will allow us to design an algorithm that tries to reduce this upper bound in order to meet this condition to be correct as fast as possible. So how do we build this lower bound? So here I give you the expression of the quantity E bar that will be, so E bar HT will be the upper bound at step H of the error at step H obtained from the past T episodes. And here we see that we have a relationship as often in the episodic settings. You can define the values, but also these upper bound inductively by just initializing them to zero in this arbitrary fake horizon H plus one. And then you have a formula which relates the error upper bound at time H, at step H, sorry, to the error upper bound at step H plus one. And so we see that this lower bound, they are completely computable. They do not depend on a policy, a reward, or on the parameter of the MDP. They just depend on the empirical transition probabilities that we know how to compute. And they depend also on the number of visits. And here, beta is some threshold function that will be tuned later, that is to be thought as some log n, basically. And so this quantity is sometimes called a confidence bonus in model-based reinforcement learning. So we call the algorithm rewrite free UCRL because it is reminiscent of the core idea that underlines this UCRL algorithm, which is an algorithm to minimize regret. So it's an algorithm for different settings, but it has in common with our algorithm that we will build confidence regions on the possible models, especially on the possible transition probabilities. And so indeed, what we prove to justify that this ugly formula for E bar is indeed with high probability an upper bound on the estimation error, we justify that on this event E, in which at every time T and in every step, the distance measured here in the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the true transition probability and the empirical transition probability is smaller than this threshold that depends on beta. So on this confidence region of possible transitions, we managed to show that for every pi and for every r, the estimation error is indeed upper bounded by E bar. So to understand where this comes from, it's actually a simple consequences of the Bellman equation. Indeed, if we are interested in so this estimation error, so the difference between the empirical Q values and the true Q value, so writing the Bellman equation for the empirical MDP and for the true MDP, you realize that if you care for the difference, actually the reward here will cancel. So you will end up with something that is easily independent of the, well, the reward is still there, but we will see how to get rid of it. So, and then rewriting a bit things, you end up by upper bounding the estimation error at step H by something that features the L1 norm between the empirical probability and the true probabilities. And this by Pinsker's inequality and by our assumption on the fact that transition probabilities are closed in Kullback-Leibler divergence, you end up here with the confidence bonus that was appearing in the bound. And then the second term is here a sum over the empirical transition probability of the error of policy pi in the next step. So here we still have a dependency in pi and r, but to get rid of pi, we will just upper bound this error by the maximum over b of the error in s prime and b. And then if you reason inductively, you can upper bound this by e bar in step h plus one, which does not depend on r. And so this upper bound on the error justifies that by induction, so we can prove that this quantity is indeed the upper bound or our estimation error. So how do we devise the algorithm based on that? So I told you that we will be greedy, so our exploration policy for the episode T plus one will look at the bound E bar we have built from the data in previous round, and we'll always choose the greedy action with respect to the upper bound. And then the stopping rule is to stop when the error in step one is smaller than epsilon over two. So why is this a good idea? Because of the definition of the fact that the policy pi is greedy with respect to E, we know that if this holds, it means that the max over A of E bar 1 of SA is smaller than epsilon over 2. But this, we proved that it was larger than the error, which is the Q pi SAR minus Q hat pi SAR. And so we have proved that by choosing because the condition was on the values, but we have proved that we have uniformly well estimated the Q value of any policy and any reward, which was, I recall, our sufficient condition to get the fact that we will be able to plan against any reward function. So this is the algorithm, and of course the prediction it makes when stopping is the current transition kernel estimated based on the model-based estimate of the transition probability. So this algorithm can actually, interestingly, be traced back to this paper of Fichter in 1994 that I was mentioning. So he was proposing an algorithm very close to this one. So it's a bit different because it was in an episodic setting. Also, the confidence bonuses were not tuned exactly as we do. But still, in spirit, from a high level, it's kind of the same algorithm. But what is funny is that this algorithm was proposed to solve the simpler Bestarm identification policy. It was proposed as an algorithm that is supposed to use the reward to find a good policy in a particular MDP. However, when you look at the bonus, like the bounds, the error bounds, E bars that are used, obviously they do not depend on the reward. And so this is why we thought that this algorithm could also be efficient for the reward-free exploration problem. And this is corroborated by the theoretical analysis we managed to give for this reward-free UCRL algorithm. So precisely, we proved that if we choose, so the remember that beta is the threshold that was appearing here in my confidence bonus. And so if beta is chosen roughly of order log 1 over delta plus s minus 1 log n, then the resulting algorithm will be epsilon delta pack. So it will output, it will be have a good transition kernel with high probability. And also with high probability, we've managed to give an upper bound on its sample complexity. So the number of episodes needed in order before stopping and outputting the transition kernel scales in H4SA divided by epsilon square multiplied by log 1 over delta plus S. So this is what we prove. And so this is actually improving the bounds that was proposed in the previous work of Shijin. So I put the bound here on the slide. So why does it improve? So there are two interesting regimes when you look at epsilon delta pack algorithms. First, you can be interested in how the bound scales when epsilon is small or when delta is small. So when epsilon is small, the dominant term in Shijin's bound is this one. And in ours, it becomes this one. So meaning that the improvement here is in the scaling in H. So if on the other hand, we look at the scaling in log 1 over delta, then our leading terms become this one, whereas the other one is this one. So we have a log cube 1 over delta versus a log 1 over delta, which is the statistical rate you expect usually in pack learning pack problems. Besides the small improvement in the bound, what I find the most interesting is that the two approaches are completely different. So we proposed an adaptive algorithm which is trying to reduce the estimation errors in all the MDP as fast as possible for any policy and any reward. Whereas the approach of Shijin is based on using regret minimization algorithm. So more precisely, what the algorithm is doing is that it is running algorithm to minimize regret for different reward functions. So there is, for each state action pair, you create an artificial reward that would be one if you manage to reach this state action pair at a given step, and zero otherwise. And so by trying to maximize reward, it means that you are trying to manage to visit this state action pair as much as possible. So the algorithm is running this regret minimizing algorithm in parallel to learn how to get in all the states. So this forms a database of policies that would take you to the states, and then you sample a lot of trajectories from random policy. So the approaches are quite different, where we have this parallel regret minimization on the one hand and this adaptive reduction of error on the other. And so we believe that RF-UCRL is a natural approach to the reward-free exploration problem. And the other nice thing is that it comes with a simple sample complexity analysis. So simple that I managed to fit in just one slide.
May I ask a clarification question?
Yeah, sure.
On your previous slide, you had O tilde, which I thought meant ignoring log terms, but you include log terms.
So this is it's ignoring log terms in the two important quantities that would be 1 over epsilon and log 1 over delta.
But you still have, log 1 over delta in the equation.
Yeah, but log term in log 1 over delta. It means what I'm ignoring is quantity of the form log log 1 over delta okay. and quantity of the form log 1 over epsilon.
Thank you. Okay. I never shown that notation.
Of course, there are logarithmic terms. We have to I should have mentioned what are the key quantities here. Thanks for the.
Thank you.
Okay. So trying to sketch briefly the proof. The idea is that, so I will denote by PHT of SA, the probability that we visit the state action pair SA at step H when using the policy that is used by the algorithm in step T. And so the key observation is that if the algorithm has not yet stopped after the in the T plus first episode, it means just by definition of the stopping rule that the error in step one for this policy is larger than epsilon over two. This is just the definition of my stopping rule. And then remembering that there is an inductive relationship between the error at different time steps, which features all this confidence bonus and the empirical probabilities, we end up with something like that, that's sums over time step and state action pairs, all these confidence bonuses. Then here we are annoyed because we still have a p hat. And so using the property that we are on this high probability events in which the p hat are close to p, we can more or less transform this into a p. And then the trick is to sum these inequalities over all time steps before t. So if we sum until the stopping time tau, here on the left we are always summing epsilon over two, so we end up with tau multiplied by epsilon over two, whereas on the right we end up with the sum over again h time step state action, and this time also on the time. And to finish the proof, actually, we use some similar technical results that can be found in regret analysis of algorithm of the style UCRL, because this number of sample is very close to the sum of the probability to visit the state action pair for a time step smaller than t. And here there is some magic happening due to the fact that here we are looking at the sum of the pH, and here we also have the pH. So this is just a technical trick that was already used in UCRL, and that makes the sum in T scales with a square root of T beta T data. So in the end, it's not too difficult to come up with this relationship between a tau multiplied by epsilon over two being smaller than something in square root t multiplied by beta. And so a consequence is that tau is necessarily smaller than the first time where this inequality cannot hold anymore. And so why it cannot hold? So here it is because we have a linear quantity in T, and here I remind you that this is log 1 over delta plus S roughly. So if this were the case, we would, so there is extra logs which makes the inversion a bit more technical, but if this were exact, then we would directly prove that tau is smaller than this divided by epsilon squared. So this is just to give you an idea that the proof is not too hard. And so the last thing I want to talk about is go back to this. So given that this RF UCRL was proposed initially in this related for the, to solve the BPI problem. So just finding one good policy in a particular MDP. We thought for a while as to what would be a good algorithm for the initial problem studied by Fischer. Because somehow RF-UCRL is too strong because it is actually able to plan for any policy, and sorry, for any reward and not just one particular reward. So of course, RF-UCRL is epsilon delta pack for best policy identification just by changing its prediction rule to be p hat, the optimal policy in the empirical MDP. It inherits the sample complexity that we saw on the previous slides. But of course, it's not using the reward, so you feel there is some room for improvement. If no, you just fix one reward function. And to check this, we can look also at lower bound. And here I am just advertising a new preprint with Omar, Pierre, and Michal, where we provide a clean proof of this lower bound that may be folklore results, but that's telling you that for any epsilon delta pack algorithm for best policy identification, you can find an MDP with stage-dependent transition. So this is actually the reason for the H-cube that would be an H-square if we were looking at stage-independent transition. So MDPs where we just have R and P and not R of H and P of H. And so we prove that the sample complexity is in H cube SA over epsilon square log one over delta. And so, yeah, so this lower bound is telling you that we are off by factor H and also this extra S. But of course, we could also have thought, well, my algorithm is not using R. I could do something better by an algorithm using reward. And indeed, some algorithm for best policy identification using reward have been proposed in the literature. The first style of methods to learn a good policy is just to use a regret minimizing algorithm. So this is a conversion proposed by Jin et al. In 2018. So I remind you that the regret is defined as the sum over all episodes of the difference between the value of the optimal policy and the value of your exploration policy. And so there exists algorithms with small regret. Especially this UCBVI algorithm of Hazard et al. Is known to attain the best possible regret in a minimax sense, which is roughly which scale in square root of h cube SAT. And so intuitively, if you have a small regret, it means that for some of the policies you played during the algorithm, they should have had a value which was close to the optimal policy. So somehow, if you run your regret minimizing algorithm, some of your past policies should be good. And so this is the idea underlying the conversion which is proposed. The idea is just to run this UCBVI algorithm up to a certain number of episode T, capital T, which is chosen as a function of H, SA, and epsilon and delta. And then the prediction, so this sample complexity is deterministic, it's fixed in advance, it's T. And when we stop, we output one of the past policy used, chosen uniformly at random. And it is not a hard computation to check that indeed this will be epsilon delta pack if T is chosen in this way, if here C is the constant that here is in my regret. So this is very nice because if you remember the lower bound, we get the right scaling in H. I was complaining that I was having an extra H in my algorithm. However, if we look at the scaling in delta, this 1 over delta square is much worse than log 1 over delta. So we do not get the right dependency in delta. So we could do some smarter conversions, but to the best of my knowledge, it's not possible to get a log 1 over delta with this conversion from regret to best policy. Maybe it's not a big deal and you view delta as a constant, but it's just that, you know, mathematically, if you look at the scaling in delta, you may need to do something different. And so the something different we suggest is to be, again, adaptive. Instead of fixing in advance a number of episodes and run a regret minimizing algorithm, we will also lean on a regret minimizing algorithm, so a UCRL type of algorithm, constructing this set of possible MDPs. But the idea will be to associate a data-dependent stopping rule to UCRL. So a UCRL algorithm constructs upper bounds not on errors as before, but on the optimal values. And so if we are able to build this bound, upper and lower bound on Q star and V star, the exploration policy of this type of algorithm is to go to be always greedy with respect to the upper bound on Q star. And then the stopping rule we propose to use is to stop when the size of the confidence interval we get for the value in step one is smaller than epsilon. And then if our prediction rule is the argmax of here the lower confidence bound, so if it's greedy with respect to this lower confidence bound, then we can prove that when we stop, we have identified the optimal policy. And so we also analyzed, and this time everything observed that everything depends on the reward, because the confidence interval you build for the Q value and the values, they will this time leverage the reward. I'm not giving details, but they use the usual Bellman equation, and there you have the reward. And so we managed to prove, actually, sadly, the exact same upper bound up to maybe slightly smaller constant hidden in my O tilde, but we managed to prove similar results. So sadly, these theoretical results do not show that BPI UCRL, which use the reward, is better in practice. However, experiments do show it. So we performed some simple experiments in a double chain MDP. So where there is a reward on one end of the chain. And so there is each time two action and the agent has also a small probability not to do what you tell him to. And so in this MDP, we ran the two algorithms and measured the empirical sample complexity on many runs. And here the y-axis is the same for the two algorithms. And the x-axis is the value of epsilon. And we see that, for example, here for epsilon equal 0.25, we have data for both algorithms. And you see that there is really an order of magnitude difference between the number of episodes needed for BPI to stop and the number of episodes needed for RF UCRL to stop. And you can also observe actually how the algorithm works. And so what we, because the algorithm are adaptive, we can try also to monitor what is the estimation error for the optimal policy after a certain number of episodes have been run. And so BPI UCRL has an error decay, which is even faster than a method using generative model, which is able to sample the full state space. And if we look at the number of visits of the different states of the chain, actually we observe that with BPI UCRL, we will visit much more the right part of the chain, whereas RF UCRL will have a more balanced exploration on the two sides of the chain, because you do not know where the reward is. So you have to be robust in the way you do exploration in order to be ready for any position of the reward. So to wrap up on what I presented, we tried to investigate the sample complexity of two pure exploration problems. So best policy identification and reward-free exploration. by providing a sample complexity upper bounds for algorithms that are epsilon delta correct. So for BPI, we show that both RF UCRL and BPI UCRL can do the job, and they fall short of matching the lower bound by this factor S and by a factor 1 power. For reward-free exploration, the S is actually necessary. This is proved by a lower bound given in the Shijin paper. However, there is still an extra H. So since then, with Pierre Ménard, we managed to find different algorithms that would get rid of the factor H, but their analysis is a bit more involved than, and also their presentation is less intuitive than this reward-free UCRL algorithm. So this is why, for simplicity, I start with a natural approach, and then using some refined tool like Bernstein confidence intervals, we manage to get better bounds, better upper bound on the error, which turns into more efficient algorithm, at least algorithm matching the lower bounds. And so as future work, I'm quite, we didn't explain what we saw in the experiment, the fact that the algorithm that uses the reward is doing much better than the algorithm that is designed for reward-free exploration. And I believe that to explain this result, actually, we need to look beyond worst-case guarantees, because if we fix the MDPs, transition kernel, and the reward, potentially there should be a scaling of the sample complexity, which depends on the MDP parameter and not just on epsilon and on the size of the states on action space. So with this, I'll conclude with a few references, and if you have a question, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you so much, Emily. Do you have any questions in the audience? I can pass on those to Emily.
Sorry, I need to. There is a problem with the sound. I cannot hear you very well. Maybe I can share for just a second. Okay, sorry, should be better.
If anyone has questions, please type in the chat box and I will be able to answer.
We didn't hear that. You said something just now. We didn't hear that.
Nidhi, you are not audible.
Sorry, I cannot hear you very well, but so if you have questions, you can maybe type it into chat and then I can try to answer.
I thought someone was saying something, but we didn't hear them very well.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, okay. It was just the host asking if anyone had questions. Okay. Does anyone have questions? We're wrapping up like right now, so I can see that some people are already leaving. Right.
Or maybe it was too simple. I should have shown you some ugly details of proof.
It was actually so very clearly explained, so it was very good. Can you say a little bit more about? Oh, someone does have a question. Connor, do you want to ask it yourself?
Sure, is my audio okay?
Yeah,
perfect.
Great, I was just asking, so when you're in the reward-free exploration setting, I think I may have missed it. Were there restrictions on the absolute values of the reward functions possible?
I think do we need the reward to be bounded? I don't remember. Yeah, I think probably we are assuming that the reward function takes value in some bounded interval, zero to some Rmax that we know, I think so. Because we are using in the analysis that the Q value is bounded by H. So we are assuming in our analysis that the rewards are bounded by one, all the individual rewards. But apart from that, it could be any function from S times A to 0, 1.
Okay, thank you. I missed that.
I forgot to write it on the slides. I think you could not know. And actually, there is some other work who are considering something like reward for exploration, except that they know they will need at the end of the exploration phase to plan again a finite number of rewards that is selected in advance. And then you can have different algorithms and different bounds. In particular, you can get rid of this extra S and replace it by a log of the number of reward function you care about. So state space, if you just care to be optimal with respect to a bunch of values, you can do better than these algorithms that are supposed to be robust to really any possible value function.